Hello and welcome to podcast, the weekly, welcome to podcast, my God, what a terrible start. Welcome to Fast Charge. It's been a long week. Can you tell maybe that it's been a long week? Welcome to Fast Charge, the weekly podcast from Tech Advisor. There we go. I am Dom. That's my name. I can handle that much. And I'm joined this week by Lewis and Toddy. Lewis, it's good to have you back after last week. Is your boiler working now?
It's working absolutely fine. I'm nice and warm. I'm good to go.
Mostly.
It has been a less eventful week than last week, I'm very pleased to say. Last week and the week before, so many things were announced. And things have calmed down a bit in the tech world this week, in that post-CES lull. Not too much of a lull, because Honor did still pick this week to throw out not only a new flagship phone, but their very first foldable, which it also happens to be the first foldable phone to feature the Snapdragon 8 Gen 1. So that is the Honor Magic V, and we'll be talking about that very soon. We are also going to be chatting this week about the iPhone 14, and most specifically the front of the iPhone 14, because there's been a lot of debate over the last 6 months or so about the notch and what Apple are doing with it, where it's going. Is it shrinking? Is it disappearing? Is it turning into a punch hole? All that kind of stuff. Some new rumors this week suggest Apple is considering some outlandish answers to that question. And we're going to talk through them and use that as a bit of a jumping off point to talk about notches, punch holes, under display cameras, and all that sort of stuff, because there's also been some new under display action from the Google side of things. And then finally today, we are going to turn to BlackBerry, which is really in a way sort of stuff that emerged from last week. But it's been an unexpectedly eventful 2 weeks for fans of BlackBerry phones. Really unexpectedly. In the year of our Lord 2022, we've had multiple major breaking stories about phones with physical keyboards. And we're going to talk about them. Partly about BlackBerry, partly about the new BlackBerry device that is, in theory, coming this year, but also things like the Planet Computer's Astro Slide, which appeared at CES last week, and that kind of space, that phone with a keyboard. Why do they still exist? Who are the people buying these things? It's not me, I'll be honest. I'm laying my cards out on the table. But people love these things. So, what are they like, and what space do they sit in at this point in the smartphone market and the smartphone industry at large? Cool. Right. Before we dive into all of that, I'm going to run through some of the other little stories from this week. One of the strangest came today. It has been reported that Samsung is making a Galaxy Home Mini 2. And you might think to yourself, did Samsung make a Galaxy Home Mini 1? And the answer is kind of, because they did make it and they did announce it a couple of times, actually, but it never went on sale. This was a Bixby smart speaker. There was the Galaxy Home and then there was the Galaxy Home Mini. Bixby smart speakers, you could apparently get the Mini as a pre-order bonus with one of the Galaxy S phones, maybe the S20, I'm not actually sure, just in South Korea. But that's it. It never went on sale. And it was a running joke in the tech industry, every Samsung event, like, oh, we're going to see some more Galaxy Home speakers, because they would just keep trotting them out on stage and being like, yeah, we're still making them. Are you ever going to sell them? Well, we're making them. And apparently they are still making them. So I don't know. Another Galaxy Home Mini speaker is allegedly actually coming. Will they sell this one? What do we think? Are they actually going to sell it?
I mean, you'd hope so. Going through all the efforts to design a second gen thing, and they've
you'd think that for the first gen.
Yeah, that's a good point, yeah.
Is it running Bixby?
I think that's the assumption, because the first gen were Bixby speakers.
Yeah. Then, no, I don't care. I don't know.
It might mean it becomes a Korea only product. Yeah. I don't know if Bixby has more take up in South Korea, as far as I'm aware, no one in the West wants to use it. And I can only assume Korean users is why Samsung, a combination of Korean users and pride is why Samsung is still sticking with Bixby at all. Because, in the Western, certainly in the Western reviewer space, we either moan about Bixby or we ignore it.
Yeah.
So the idea of buying a Bixby smart speaker is almost comical. You know, it's just nonsense. You wouldn't do it. Maybe they're going to partner with Google and it will have Google on it, or the option of having Google on it, have Google and Bixby. It could be that the Western release has Google Assistant. These are all options. They would all make a lot more sense than trying to sell a Bixby speaker in Europe. But yeah, I mean, or maybe it's all fluff and nonsense and bad rumors, and this thing is vaporware. So we'll see. Sticking with Samsung and things they may or may not be announcing, the Exynos 2200, which is the chipset expected to power some Galaxy S22 phones, and also the chipset we are expecting to reveal their GPU partnership with AMD and the first fruits of that. That was announced 2 days ago. Except it wasn't, because they announced that they were announcing it on the 11th of February. And then nothing happened on the 11th of February. And they quietly deleted all the social media posts where they had announced that they were announcing it. Then they kind of waited a bit. And now Samsung has put out a statement, I think in response to questioning, but through a Korean publication, they have said, we are still announcing it, but it's now going to be announced with the S22. So we were expecting the chip to come first. They're now going to combine the two into either one launch event, or at least launch events that are much closer together in time. Later speculation is the S22 is going to be February 8th for a launch. Certainly we're expecting something around then. So that's only a few weeks away. So it's not, you know, a massive delay. It is a little odd because I feel like Samsung launch events don't tend to go deep dives on CPU specs. So I can't imagine they're actually going to be in the same presentation, because I think a lot of people who want to know about the phone don't want to know about, you know, how many CPU cores it has. But we'll see. So yeah, Exynos 2200, we thought by now we would know everything about it. And I actually did think we were going to talk about that today. But thanks, Samsung, we're not. Right. More delayed things. The Xperia 5 Mark III is on sale in the US, finally. It went on sale in Europe a couple months ago because I reviewed it. I honestly thought it was on sale in the US. It turns out it wasn't.
So did I.
And it's now on sale this week. This is 9 full months after they announced the phone. And not just teased the phone, like announced it, specs. And full specs, photos, everything. You know, the phone existed 9 months ago.
They could have given themselves so much more leeway, because with the previous generation, like the Xperia 1 Mark II came out, and then the 5 Mark III came out about 5 months later, I think it was, 6 months later. This time, as you just said, like they showed off both phones at the same time, and they'd be like, they're coming really soon. And then they were really nebulous about the 1 Mark III, and they said it was going to be summer, and it was summer, but like late summer. And it was, again, no one knew which markets that meant.
Yeah,
and now this, it's just, I don't know why they were so adamant that they needed to tell people the phone was already kind of in existence.
And even more so, because those phones were announced, if I'm right, I think it was a little after February last year, given the 9 month line, so it must have been a bit later.
Sounds right.
But it was still them aiming clearly kind of roughly for the MWC window when they normally launch their phones. But there was no MWC, or rather it was, but it was later in the year and they didn't use that anyway. So it's like, why were they rushing for this spring window that they didn't have to hit, and they couldn't ship the phones anyway? And they must have known at the time they announced them, they must have known on some level they were going to struggle to ship devices anytime soon and that there was going to be a delay. Anyway, it's done. We can stop talking about the three series of Xperia phones and wait for them to announce the Mark IVs, which will take 18 months to hit shelves.
Yeah, we'll hear about them in like 2 months' time, and then we'll see them in about a year and a half's time.
Yeah. Maybe they just couldn't make them, so too busy building PS5s.
Fair.
Right, on to things that are actually, or also actually going on sale. The OnePlus 10 Pro, we obviously spoke about that a lot last week, so we're not going to go in depth on the 10 Pro again, but it's had the Chinese launch now. OnePlus had announced so many specs and things that there was nothing new really on that front, other than a little more of a deep dive into some of the technical bits, like how the display worked and the camera stuff. So go look that up if you're interested. The interesting thing, I think, is pricing, just because the price, we only have Chinese pricing for the phone because it's a Chinese launch, but each setup of the phone is approximately $50 to $100 converted cheaper than the 9 Pro was. So if you're sitting there trying to figure out what the 10 Pro price might end up as, bear that in mind, that in China, at least, they have given this thing a price drop relative to the 9 Pro. And it seems fair to assume they might be looking at the same for a Western release. That is what gives me a bit more interest in this phone in a way, because we've said before that there's not a lot that's changed here from the previous gen. The chipset's changed, charging and battery are better, the camera's had some tweaks, but it's mostly the same hardware. So if they've gone and then said, you know, if they're acknowledging that by shaving a bit off the price, that makes it a much more compelling option than it would be if it came in at the same price as the 9 Pro. So a little bit of reason to hope that we're getting a minor price drop year on year, at least there. And finally, Huawei, the P50 Pro and P50 Pocket have launched outside of China. Not in many places, I'm going to caveat that with right now. As far as I know right now, it's Malaysia and Saudi Arabia.
And they're both pre-orders. They're not even on sale, technically.
It's not technically on sale, but there are pre-orders. There are prices for those markets. You can put money down, or at least, you know, promise to put money down to get these phones at some point. So we still know nothing more about whether we're going to get a broader global release, whether we're going to get a European release.
The caveat to that, I have now asked Huawei, I think it was like today or last night, but Huawei Germany has said 26th of Jan for the P50 Pro. They didn't mention the Pocket, I don't think. I know they mentioned both. Both, 26th of Jan for Germany. And I've asked whether that means other European markets and the UK as well. So that's what we're waiting to hear back on.
Oh, cool. Okay, so it could be pretty soon for Europe.
It could happen.
Yeah.
What's funny is, it's going to happen.
Yeah, at least so far. I mean, we'll see what they do in Germany. Maybe it will be different, but it's been with little fanfare. It was more just people kind of noticed, oh, there's a pre-order button on the Malaysian Huawei website. You know, they haven't made a fuss about the global launch, at least not yet. But maybe they'll do a big simultaneous European one and make a bit more noise about that. But yeah, so if you're interested in the P50 Pro and probably more the P50 Pocket, which certainly has a lot of interest as a foldable, they've obviously both got all the usual Huawei Android problems, but hardware-wise, hopefully fantastic. And if you're willing to put the money down for them, they should, in theory, be coming soon.
Are you interested in the P50 Pro, Dom, as the flip, the resident flip aficionado?
The Pocket,
fan?
Yes. Yeah, the Pro.
The Pocket,
not.
Sorry. Yeah, yeah.
The Pro I would have been a year ago. It's just...
Yeah, sure.
It's a little past it. And, you know, even like we always say Huawei, they kill it on camera, and it's kind of going to be interesting for that alone. But I just feel like, you know, I look at things like the Vivo X70 Pro Plus that I reviewed recently, and I think, can the P50 Pro really beat that? I'm not convinced. Or the Pixel 6 Pro, you know, those are both phenomenal. I'm not sure that Huawei's camera is going to best those, especially given it's a year old. Pocket is interesting because I love those little clamshell foldables, obviously. I mean, because of the software, it would never be my daily driver, you know.
Sure.
But keen to try out more in that space. And also the fresh leaks this week on the Motorola Razr, the next one. For a while, it had gone quiet, and it kind of looked like maybe Motorola had given up on it. But there were some new leaks. I can't remember what they are. I haven't delved into them myself. But I know there have been leaks. So it looks like we're getting another Razr. So the only clamshell space seems to be alive and well.
Maybe a Snapdragon 8 Gen 1. I think that was the only thing I saw. Mm.
I mean, that's a big improvement because it was mid-range when they first pushed it out. So yeah. I'll take that.
Yeah, I mean, I think the thing is, it was maybe a victim of the timing, because at the time they put the Razr out, Motorola didn't make anything beyond mid-range.
Yeah.
And since then, they've made a really conscious kind of lean into, we make flagships again now, just as they stopped doing their foldables for a year or two. So it kind of makes sense now, I think, for them to come back and say, right, okay, if we're going to be a flagship-level company, and we have foldable tech, like we figured that one out.
Yeah.
They might as well lean into it and go all the way. I think they just need to figure out a way to make it work that's less reliant on nostalgia. I think nostalgia carried a lot of people through the first gen and through some of its ups and downs. I think they now need to make a product that carries the Razr name, but doesn't necessarily go so hard on aping the look, because it's just got to be a clamshell foldable that works well and can compete with the Z Flip.
Yeah.
And they may have to give up on a couple of the Razr-y touches to really deliver on that.
Yeah.
I feel. But yeah, we'll see what they come up with. I'm excited for more in that space, obviously. So that's cool. Well, perfect excuse to start talking about Honor. So the Honor Magic V is the first foldable phone from Honor. It's not a clamshell, sadly. It is a book-style foldable, you know, kind of similar, roughly, form factor to the Galaxy Z Fold or the Oppo Find N or the Xiaomi Mix Fold. It's in that sort of space. It's interesting because, as I said, it's got the Snapdragon 8 Gen 1. So Honor is another company, in a way like Motorola, that doesn't always go into proper flagships. It sometimes kind of shies away from going too high-end with its products. And I think I was certainly expecting their foldable to go for more affordable hardware other than the folding bit. And in some respects, they have done that. But certainly in the chipset, they've not skimped. They've gone all in and gone for a full premium flagship experience from the chip side of things. Yeah, Toddy, you followed the launch more closely than I did because I was enjoying a day off in response to CES overwork. So what exactly have Honor announced?
The big hook is really the Snapdragon 8 Gen 1. I think the thought that a lot of people in the run-up to this phone's launch, because Honor teased it and we covered rumours on it, I believe you covered rumours on it, Dom, was...
Yeah, I know everything we thought Honor was going to announce.
Everything we thought we knew, you know.
I don't know what they actually announced in detail.
Yeah, I guess the question I had in my mind before they actually like pulled the wraps off was how close to the Huawei Mate X2 this was going to be.
Yeah. Yes.
Because obviously we don't know when in the process this was unpicked from that master plan when they were all one company still or under the same, you know, parent. So in some ways you can see the Mate X2 in it, but overall I'd say it does feel like a fairly different beast. The design does look different. The camera setup is very different. Obviously, they've built it around a Snapdragon 8 Gen 1, which means like thermals and stuff, they would have had to take that into consideration when they were developing the hardware, the rest of the hardware. So it feels maybe more discreetly Honor than anyone was expecting. And maybe the most distinctly Honor phone that we've seen so far since the parting of Honor and Huawei.
Yeah, because all of the big flagship phones they've put out this year have clearly still been hangovers from the Huawei days. And,
absolutely.
Know, I mean, no disrespect to that. Mostly very nice phones, but you can see for each of them, like, oh, there's the matching Huawei device that they clearly were working. They built that chassis. They designed that already. And we were waiting to see the first one that was all Honors. This feels half like that. I'll say the big obvious thing that looks like a Huawei tech is the hinge, because it's got the creaseless kind of teardrop hinge where it doesn't fold the screen harshly, it kind of pushes it out and squishes it a bit,
which is how we saw Razer do it, and I think the Z Fold does that as well.
Well, the Z Fold doesn't, and this is where it's one of those funny things. I saw a lot of coverage around the Honor being like, oh yeah, they've got that Huawei and Oppo style folding display, and I did see at least one person correct this, but credit to them, Motorola invented this, or at least did it first in the public space. Yeah. This is how the Razer screen worked, and it is why the Razer has a less noticeable crease than any of Samsung's foldables. This is the one area Samsung feels a bit behind, and it's because it's still very creasy in the middle of the screen.
They actually call it creaseless in this, in the spec sheet. That, like, it's a creaseless display.
Feels optimistic. Obviously, I haven't seen one in person. I feel like there must be a crease.
There's definitely a crease. We're not there yet, are we?
Yeah, and the big differentiation there is that, yes, Samsung's foldables may have more of a crease than the other foldables, but they're also the only company pumping out water-resistant foldables right now.
Yes.
Which is tied into how the hinge and the screen folding works. So exactly, that's inherently an impressive...
Yeah. Samsung have other advantages, and But this specific hinge design... So this is that one bit you look at and you say, that's probably the hinge Huawei designed that's in the Mate X2. It's probably broadly that hinge tech. In terms of the rest of the design, the camera stuff, it's definitely not a copy paste of the Mate X2.
No, which I was expecting, to be honest. Yeah.
There's one thing I only noticed when putting together all the stuff for the episode today, when I was and had that image that we'd had put together, which is the first time I'd really properly looked closely at the design. And I love the camera module where the rings of the cameras are overlapping over each other.
Yeah, with that middle one kind of like half covered.
Yeah, it's a subtle thing. It's actually a really nice looking design, I think, and a subtle way to make a camera module look a bit different.
And not something we've seen from any of the other Honor phones that I can think of.
Yeah.
You know, because of that, you know, was it the Nova 9 from Huawei and the, what was the one you reviewed at the end of last year that looks, is basically the Nova 9? Effectively, the camera sensor.
The Honor 50. I think it was the Honor 50.
Honor 50, that sounds right. The Nova 9. Yeah, yeah. Those camera sensors are so wildly different design-wise. So yeah, I like the design of this. I think there's the, if you've seen a thumbnail for this stream, there's the orange vegan leather option, but there's also two glassback ones. There's a silver and a black, I think it is. They all look quite nice. I don't have any kind of qualms about any of the aesthetics of any of these. I think they look great.
The orange is a bit much for me, but I felt the same about when Oppo did the same bright
my
orange
first
leather.
Thought as well. Yeah.
It's a nice design.
I was just going to say, you got two front-facing cameras, so like one on the cover display, one on the main display.
And they're both punch-hole, right? Yeah.
Yes, but they're not under display like
Samsung
tried.
No, under display,
thankfully.
We'll get to that later.
Yes.
later. 350 meg sensors on the back, which is the biggest difference, I think, from the Mate X2. Had one lead 50 and then a 12 meg and an 8, like ultra-wide and a telephoto.
So what are they? Are they a main, a telephoto, and an ultra, or is it something different?
No, it's there's
it doesn't look like a telephoto. I assume there's a main and a wide.
An ultra wide, and then what are they? It's like with the P50 Pocket we were talking about the other week, where it was like some weird
spectrum enhanced sensor.
There we go. Spectrum, they use the word spectrum again. Exactly.
50 megapixels spectrum enhanced sensor.
Yeah. Yeah, I don't know what exactly that means. They didn't have as many examples. I was trying to figure out examples. They didn't show any obvious examples during both the stream and on the product pages on Honor's Chinese website. So for whatever that is, it has one of those and it's 50 megapixels. So that's good, I guess.
Slapped a H on it and just been like, yeah, it's a fake.
Yeah,
It's an odd one because, you sometimes see like monochrome lenses and things like that are there to do things like add extra color information or depth sensing and things like that. But if that was all it was, it wouldn't be 50 megapixel. If that's what it was for. You're only going 50 megapixel if you intend that to be a lens you can switch to be like, I'm going to take a photo with the spectrum lens now. Who knows what they do?
Radioactive waves in the air. Who knows? We'll be seeing ultraviolet.
Yeah, it's got 66 watt wired charging. And then beyond that, really, I think the focus was actually more about the software, which is obviously a big question for how any company with its first big screen foldable like this approaches window management, app management, multitasking, all that kind of stuff. They kind of use an umbrella term. I think it was called, Magic Life, which I wrote down somewhere. So it's Magic UI 6 atop Android 12, but it has this thing called Magic Life, which is basically they're branding it as some sort of AI informed assistant functionality, not like a voice assistant, but like being able to throw up apps or suggestions for maybe screen layouts based on what you're doing or where you are or your schedule or whatever.
Yeah.
So if that works, great. It's just one of those things that the demos are always going to be perfect. And I think the reality is going to be very different and we need to see it to believe it sort of thing in real world usage.
Yeah. The important note to throw in with an Honor thing again is they do have Google now. This will, it will run with Google support. So if you're still, if you're not up to date on the latest there, this, if and when it ships outside of China, and there's been no official word on whether it ever will, to my knowledge. So, this may stay China only, but if it does launch elsewhere, it will launch with proper Google, which will help a lot.
I wrote an opinion piece at the time about how the Find N has the potential to take on the Z Fold 3 as a good international foldable, and yet Oppo still hasn't brought it.
Funny, we're just waiting for someone to challenge Samsung. Samsung has complete dominance of that market because there was Motorola at the beginning, and then Motorola have stopped for now, and maybe they're doing another one, but no time soon. And that's it. Outside of, China's now got four or five, companies pushing foldables.
Never
out,
got the Mi Mix Fold from Xiaomi. That never came out.
This is the thing, you just need someone to come and undercut them by literally £100, and people will be like, oh, hello.
And this is what I thought. I thought Honor would do something that undercut the Samsung on value, and that they could at least consider giving a limited European launch.
Yeah.
And maybe they still will. They certainly over the last year, they're sort of the new Honor, there's been big, lengthy gaps between Chinese launches and Western launches. And I'm sure it's just them, the combination of COVID, chipset shortages, and they're fundamentally like a new company now, and they're figuring out how to do it all again. And I'm sure that has a lot of challenges, but I really hope we see this launch in the West. Yeah. I hope that Oppo, bring the Find N. I think we can probably give up on the Xiaomi Mix Fold now, but maybe the second gen of that will get a global release, because I like the Samsung stuff, but man, it'd be nice to have a choice. It'd be nice to have the variety in the market, and it would give Samsung the push to improve things, because Samsung has a lot of competition in China, and obviously that is a key market for all these players, don't get me wrong. But Samsung can at least rest on its laurels a little bit and be like, well, we're the only ones in the US and we're the only ones in Europe. So, you know, we're guaranteed, as long as it's good enough, Samsung's guaranteed domination of those big markets for now at least. So I want them to get the competition. Though on the US side, I mean, unless the Google Pixel Fold turns out to be real, I don't know when they would get competition, because Xiaomi, Oppo and Honor and Huawei are never launching theirs in the States. They might come to Europe, but not the States.
It would Motorola, just be up to Motorola, which is Motorola Lenovo, which could cause issues. I don't know, even though Motorola is a very popular brand in the States. Yeah.
So they've at least still got the US to themselves for a while. Though, yeah, well, you know, fresh rumors that the Pixel Fold is coming, but we're actually going to get to that in a bit. The other thing I wanted to talk about that I did spot in the specs on the Magic V that surprised me, and I know I'm not the only person slightly surprised by this, is the exterior display is 120 hertz, but the interior folding display is only 90 hertz, is a little unusual to do it that way around.
I want to know where that panel's from. I'm curious who that panel came from, because it's not... I'm like, is it an old Samsung panel from like the previous
folds?
That's
true, because Samsung's... Yeah.
Because they're 120 hertz.
Their current ones are 120, obviously.
Yeah. So who is making that panel? Because I don't think... Yeah. I mean, I don't know. But yeah, that would be an interesting thing to find out, to know whether it's technically like a Z Fold 2 panel or something. That was my first guess.
I guess that could be it, of their availability of 120 hertz flat panels for the outside versus their availability of 120 hertz folding panels to their specification. I mean, the dimensions are different to the Fold, so it can't be literally fold panels. But yeah, maybe the same tech, and maybe that's part of the price. I mean, I've seen some people justify on the basis that you're more likely to use the exterior display for like phone stuff, which is when you're kind of flicking around apps a lot, scrolling a lot, things like that. And you're more likely to use the interior display for multimedia, which is maybe when you get less benefit from the refresh rate anyway, and kind of a justification of why it may not be the, I mean, handicap's too strong a word even, but it may not be the minor, like, oh, that's a shame that you think it is, because actually for the things you use that interior display for, how many of those benefit from the high refresh rate?
Yeah, off the top of my head, I think pricing is probably, that's where pricing is kind of reflected most obviously, is the refresh rate stuff. And obviously we don't know how good the cameras are. Mm. But I think it threads a nice needle between the Find N, which is a little bit cheaper based on Chinese pricing. And I think the Z Fold 3 is pricier if you go based on the Chinese pricing of the Z Fold 3. But obviously Honor's got a much, they're much better positioned in China than Samsung is actually in terms of brand awareness. So
yeah, and you know, there. they've talked a lot about it, but you know, even when they broke out from Huawei and kind of had their, you know, even in China, they went quiet for 6 months or so and couldn't really release anything and then came back. But they were very bullish that they immediately shot back up to like 25% market share in China or something crazy like that. They very quickly carved out a big chunk of the Chinese market for themselves again.
Which is arguably the most competitive mobile market in the world.
So it's clearly a popular brand in China in a big way. Yeah. And they, I'm sure a lot of that comes from their cheaper phones, not from, you know, the high-end flagship stuff like this. So it's a bit different, but still. They've got clout in China and they could do very well from this if, by Chinese pricing, this is a relatively affordable foldable.
Yeah, it starts at 9,999 yen, Chinese yen, which equates to about 1,150 pounds or 1,370 euros or $1,570, if that's helpful for anyone.
And one of the other reference points that might be useful there is that's a little over half the price of the Mate X2.
Which is crazy.
Yeah. It's a lot cheaper than the Mate X2, like a lot.
Yeah. And you get Android.
I was surprised to see it's more than the Find N. I didn't realize how cheap the Find N was.
Find N is impressively competitive.
Yeah.
Yeah, for sure.
Very affordable.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, the big question with a lot of this will be how that camera turns out.
Yeah.
Especially because on paper, it looks like they've gone quite hard on the camera spec, which is quite interesting. Obviously, with this odd third lens, we're not really sure what it does. Is a big caveat.
Spectrum
there.
Stuff.
Magic.
Yeah, that's what I've been missing on my phone. Enhanced spectrum experiences.
Yeah. But we won't know until, I think, 18th of Jan is when it launches, like goes on sale in China. It's on pre-order now. But cool. Yeah, we've got a few more days before people actually be able to get hands on it.
Mm-hmm. But yeah, I really like the look of this. I'm pleasantly surprised. I think the other omission that's worth mentioning is, correct me if I'm wrong, there's no wireless charging.
No. No, just which 66 think, watt wired.
Yeah.
4,750 battery.
I think at this decent price, it's kind of one of the things people will go a bit like, you know, you kind of expect wireless, maybe.
I feel like it makes a lot more sense with Samsung's foldable because they already spent so much time with, you know, putting wireless charging into their headphones and watches as well, and then having that ecosystem, which Honor doesn't really have.
No. And Samsung's gone big on wireless charging in part because it can't go big on fast charging.
Yeah.
And it keeps compensating it. So, like, we know our wired charging is slow because we don't want any more batteries to explode. But,
yeah,
you know, good times. Flip side of that is they've gone pretty committed quite hard on putting wireless in as many products as they can. And with the reverse wireless building up, as you said, the ecosystem idea where, you know, they get to do lots of press shots of Galaxy Buds charging on the back of S21s and things like
yeah.
that.
Yeah.
Cool. Yeah. So we hope the Magic V will launch elsewhere. I would really like to see it, but we'll keep an eye out. You know, Honor has a bit of an iffy track record here. The Honor 50 launched last year, that is out in the West, but the Magic 3 flagships, they promised a global launch and it still hasn't materialized. I think we're like 4 or 5 months on now, something like that. And there's still no word on when they're actually going to go on sale elsewhere. And, you know, you're getting to the point where you're thinking maybe they just won't. So there are question marks around their ability to put it out globally. But yeah, this looks like a really strong entry. It's, if nothing else, just every time a new brand enters the foldable space, I'm excited because, you know, not to sound super like pro-capitalist, because God, I'm not, but competition is good in lots of ways. And, you know, more competition in the market will make more people make better foldable phones. So we will see, you know, Samsung's had a bit of a need to improve itself, but now that suddenly it's staring down the barrel of 5 competitors, like, it's got to step up. Everyone's got to step up. And also prices have got to start going down. So if you want better foldable phones, this is only good news.
Bring that price down.
I just wish more of them were making clamshells, because I want all that competition in the clamshell segment.
Yeah,
the good bits of foldables.
My great aunt invested in the Flip 3 because she just loved the look of it so much. Like,
nice.
Yeah. Foldables, man, they're for everybody.
I mean, I do wonder, because I think all the stats we've seen show that the Flip is outselling the Fold quite comfortably, I think, which does make it interesting that every other brand has gone... Well, except Motorola again, but pretty much every other brand has gone straight to a book style.
Yeah.
And I wonder if everyone thought that was going to be the thing. And I do wonder if we're going to see the market shift a bit now, because maybe people are going to look and go, oh, wait, okay. For Samsung, at least, the clamshell is clearly the bigger success.
They are also working on a Westworld style, like, tri-foldable as well. Did you see this at CES?
Yes.
They teased that. That looks nice. So fun. Like as soon as I was like, now we're in the future. Okay, Westfield is real, guys.
Yeah, the trifold one is very cool. Obviously, rollables, you know, we're still waiting for a rollable you can actually really, you know, buy and get your hands on. But yeah, more of this stuff is for the good. Okay, so let's turn to Apple. I want to talk about the iPhone 14. Lewis, you're you know, more on the nose of this stuff than me. What is going on with the iPhone 14 notch? What you know, take us through the journey from the current notch. So we had the notch arrived with the iPhone 10 years ago. Yep. It's basically been there ever since. It shrunk a bit last year. We've got a smaller notch, but only in a kind of, if you put them side by side, you'll notice it's smaller. If you just looked at it, you maybe wouldn't guess.
Is just really annoying when you put together screenshots as well, because the time is slightly blocked off by the bigger notch. So it's just enough to be an inconvenience to tech journalists, but nobody else notices.
But we're expecting a bigger change for the 14, right?
Yes. Well, some models are 14. It's likely going to be the Pro models to get this new kind of cut out, and the regular models will stick with that notch. Maybe they'll get the smaller one, but I'm not too sure about that.
Right.
So, it started a while ago. These rumors have been coming around, going around for ages, and first rumor was no notch, no nothing. It's all going under display. Okay, it's going to be absolutely amazing. Face ID is going to work absolutely flawlessly. And then as time passed, obviously people realized with the under display cameras on the Android side that it's not actually all it's cracked up to be.
And maybe it's not up to Apple standards.
Just a little bit. So then there was this, it was one person that said this, but it kind of stuck around for a while. They said that there wasn't going to be a display, but the bezels would get slightly thicker all the way around, and then they'd just be housed within that slightly thicker bezel. So no notch, nothing like that, but just kind of more iPad-esque in the bezel.
I remember when this was like announced, it was this kind of like novel new design. It's like, no, that's just what phones were.
I was about to say, yeah, cost your mind back like 5 years ago, and that is literally that. Imagine that.
That's literally what we used to have. And fascinating then, the way that got presented as novel and an exciting
I know, like absolutely game-changing thing, guys. Hide stuff in that bezel. Okay.
Yeah.
There's stuff we can do with that. So, and then, yeah, so that was that for a while. And then more recently, there was an analyst that said that it was going to be a hole punch camera. That's all it was. It was just hole punch. There was no description of what that hole punch might look like. A few other people kind of jumped on that. There was other reports from industry sources that said, yep, hole punch is coming to the iPhone 14. Probably the pro models. And then, yeah, everyone kind of jumped on that. And that was it for a while. For the last few months, everyone was like, yep, hole punch is coming, hole punch is coming. And then this week came along. And this is from, this is again from an analyst. But this analyst has got absolutely nothing wrong so far when it comes to iPhone display predictions. He has 100% track record. So it's worth paying attention to this. So apparently there will be a hole punch on the iPhone 14, but it will be a combination of a pill and a hole punch, alongside each other. And
so for clarification, for anyone who's not sure, by a hole punch we mean a circle,
yes,
and by pill a kind of oblongy cylindrical sort of shape next to it.
So kind of
with a gap
like,
between them,
looking like Morse code essentially.
Oh, yes, a gap between them.
Yeah.
This is the this is what people are saying, that there will be screen between the two.
I was picturing, is it Huawei Mate 30, I think, had dual front-facing cameras, so it had a pill-shaped notch. So
it'll have that and pill-shaped one next to it.
Cutout. Right, right. So regular circle and then a pill, okay, with pointless pixels in between.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Fine. One possible like caveat there is a point that was made by, I think it was Max Weinberg on Twitter, that this seems very unlikely that we'll have the screen between, because even if, say, this analyst is correct and this is the camera setup they're going for and all of that, surely Apple would essentially just turn off the display between the two. And because it's OLED, it would just, you know, have black pixels between the two bits, and you basically wouldn't be able to tell. So what it would actually be is a long pill.
And then you might
and
that,
yes, technically it may be a circle and then a pill, but there's actually black between them, and that would make more sense. And that's what I think sounds more likely, because the dot, then the pill with screen in between sounds hideous.
I've just thrown a photo of it up on the stream, so people that are watching the stream can have a little look at this mock-up of this monstrosity.
Are we to assume that this is all centrally justified like the notch currently is as well? Like, is this all in the center top of the screen?
Yes.
Because like, I can understand if it was like
a
camera in the top left or right, and then the sensor in the middle or the other side, like top other opposing corner, maybe.
No, it's both together in the middle with just a little gap between them.
Ever so slight.
Yeah, I mean, the question, you know, you said why not just the notch? And to be honest, that's what I feel about all of these debates, is I don't see why Apple would go for a punch hole or a pill hole or whatever when they could just do the notch. Because, and I've said this before, but like, the notch is a recognizable Apple design choice now.
Yeah.
And they've had plenty of time to ditch it and move to something else, or do a long punch hole or something. But the thing is, everyone on the Android side does that. And the moment they do that, they look just like all the Android phones from the front. And one of the odd little strengths of the notch, and I'm not a huge fan of it, but at least when you see the front of an iPhone, you immediately know it's an iPhone because it's got a notch. And yes, there was a year or two when all the Androids had notches, but every Android manufacturer then moved on from them and Apple stuck with it. And now it's an Apple thing. It's a trademark design. They can do the little silhouette on the Apple website with a notch cutter and you immediately recognize it's an iPhone.
I mean, they can even put it on a MacBook. And that goes down so well.
Exactly. And I just don't see why they'd move away from it unless they're ready to move to under display camera. There's nothing. Like, I don't see what they gain from this move. And I'm not, you know, the analysts are saying there's enough evidence building up that it does look quite likely. So I'm not saying I doubt this. I'm just confused by it. I don't know what Apple is thinking.
It is a little bit weird because they are, you know, if this is true, they're further fragmenting the design because they've already, in the last 3 years, they've gone from full size notch to medium size notch to weird hole punch. And that doesn't seem very Apple. Like, I feel like they wait for it to be ready. They put it in one thing and then they put it on everything. And it's that exact same thing.
Especially because, as Tony said, we're now getting the notch on MacBook and stuff. They're spreading the notch out. And this is why we've had this conversation before, but when the first rumors were that they'd be ditching the notch for the iPhone 14, I was like, there's no way in hell they put the notch on a MacBook and then immediately remove it from the iPhone. You know, them putting it on the MacBook was partly their way of saying, Apple is notches. Like, it's the notch company.
Yeah.
And having time to reflect on it now, I feel like the move with the iPhone 13 generation to reduce the size of the notch was almost counterproductive to that brand identity, and you know, it didn't really present the user with any real gain. It was just an admission that they could do it smaller, but I think they should have just stuck with the same size notch they'd have the past two generations or three generations.
I think for better or worse,
like you say,
what fits the Appliness of this whole scenario is they should just be bullish and be like, we do notches are great, there's nothing wrong with a notch, the notch is the perfect thing, we designed iOS around the notch. Hey, look, we're going to design macOS around the notch too, because notches are so good. Up until the point where they're ready to say, notches are dead, we've killed the notch because now there's nothing. You know?
Yeah.
When you said earlier, Lewis, about one of the potentials of it, them just having thicker bezels, or at least a thicker top bezel with a camera in it, that also sent alarm bells ringing because, well, for two reasons. As we talked about earlier, the Xperia 1 Mark III and all of the kind of latest Xperia 1 series the past few generations, they have done that. They have a thin bezel with a tiny front-facing camera in it. And the front-facing camera is very run-of-the-mill, very bland, very underwhelming, which is terrible on a phone that's like £1,200, $1,400, and is kind of all about the camera experience. To have that rubbish front camera is pretty damning, I think, against the whole push of the phone. And also iPhones, I would posit, are some of the best in terms of front-facing camera quality out there.
Yeah.
Mainly because, you know, developers pander to that as well. You know, like, there's always been talk about how Snapchat and other apps like that use a viewfinder on Android phones versus the camera output on iPhones. So all of that, I feel like they're just doing themselves a disservice.
They've also got the thing of the Face ID tech, which takes up space. Those sensors are big sensors, and that's why we have the notch. They don't need the notch for their camera. They need the notch for all of Face ID. And again, I don't know how much they can shrink that to fit it in a bezel without that being a big bezel. So
they should
sure about that.
Yeah, wait till they can do a good front camera or under display camera, and at the same time reintroduce Touch ID as in display. Those should happen together. That makes the most sense.
One big display overhaul, where they get to say suddenly the display is more functional than before, and you know, seamless and everything.
Sorry, Lewis.
No, I was just going to say, I think for me, I wouldn't want any of the performance of Face ID to change. Like, that's my fundamental thing, is that I think, you know, over the course of the last few years, Face ID has got to the point where as soon as I look at the phone, it's unlocked. Like, you know, it wasn't like that first, but
it just needs a mask feature.
Exactly.
If they're still not going to put Touch ID back in, they cannot compromise Face ID, and they can't risk looking like they've compromised Face ID. And MacBook presents problems here if they want to make changes, because the way they sold the MacBook notch is, we couldn't fit a camera this good into the bezel. Like, we had to do a notch because our camera's so good it needs a notch. So the moment you then remove the notch from the iPhone, it's like, oh, so the camera's not good there. Even if it is, it's like, well, the messaging is, we couldn't be bothered to fit a good camera in here. We went for we shrunk it down instead of doing a good one. On the MacBook, good camera, notch. Here, like, bad camera, no notch.
The MacBook notch, though, didn't include Face ID, did it? They still had Touch ID on the keyboard?
Yeah.
Is that right?
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't think it has Face ID.
No.
That doesn't make, like, they have so much more room to play with. Like, if you put an iPhone notch next to a MacBook notch, like, the amount of extra real estate they have to work with there is madness.
Absurd not to throw Face ID on the Mac. Yes. That's a whole different question.
Sure.
The other sort of interesting development this week, along this kind of line, particularly about under display stuff, is it was a fresh patent discovered by Let's Go Digital, which is a Google patent for an under display camera, which is the second one we've seen, but it's kind of further evidence that Google is now seriously looking at under display cameras. The first patent that was a year or so ago was a really odd one where they envisaged having prisms to like reflect the light inside the phone and bounce it up. And it was a way of getting around the clear screen bit. Very odd, looked cool, but sort of like, in theory, wouldn't compromise the camera quality as much, I think was the thinking, but suddenly a bit more space needed for it and delicate bits internally. Now they've had a patent that's gone out this week that is a much more traditional, you know, I say traditional, the tech's only a year or two old, but much more in line with what Samsung and ZTE people are doing in terms of layers of display that can at different levels of opacity. What's interesting as well is that the this new patent specifically names a Google employee who's been at Google for 3 or so years, but before that was a Samsung AMOLED display expert. And you can't help but look and be like, ah, right. So this guy was presumably involved in the early days of Samsung building this tech and then got poached by Google or left for Google and has been leading the charge on the Google side of taking what Samsung knows and building Google's version of it while skirting around whatever, you know, patent infringement they need to not do.
Sure.
But it now looks pretty, I mean, there's no evidence yet that this is for the Pixel 7 or for the Pixel Fold that we hope is coming. But whether it's this year or next or even beyond, it definitely looks like Google is ready to jump on this. And that gives me hope because, I mean, this is funny. I think we kind of thought with Samsung, well, Samsung wouldn't put the under display camera in the Fold unless it was ready. And it wasn't really ready.
Definitely wasn't.
But Google, I really think they wouldn't. Not on their phones, not where camera is their thing. Which is not to say Google never puts out products that are a bit half-baked, because there's been enough dodgy Pixel Buds to disprove that very quickly.
And the Soli sensor in the Pixel 4 series. Like.
So even on the Pixel side, they do it. But not camera. Like, camera is their brand.
Yeah.
And so I struggle to see Google putting out a Pixel where any camera, even the selfie camera, was significantly below par. And the current under display camera tech we've seen is significantly below par in terms of selfie camera quality. And so if Google's looking at it, you kind of have to think Google's figured it out somehow. Because or at least they are trying to figure it out.
I mean, I will say that I think it was ZTE on one of the Axons I looked at that had an under-display camera, and that
the 30, I think,
because you looked at the second gen.
It was a standard 30. It wasn't the Ultra, because that was the weird thing. They put it on the 30, but not the Ultra. But I think that for me is the best implementation of an under-display camera so far, because you couldn't actually see it in the display unless you looked at it from a very fine angle.
The Fold 3 was around the same time, which made their implementation so embarrassing. By comparison.
And
in fairness, that was ZTE's second time around.
Yeah,
that
true,
was their
true.
Second gen of the tech, but still, there's a lot better. So it gives hope that this is getting there. And again, it's like foldables. We just need more brands in this space. We need more companies trying it out and pushing it forwards a little bit.
Yeah.
But it's encouraging to see Google is doing it. And again, this is why Apple moving to a punch hole or something just feels odd, because that looks like they're aping an old Android design trend right around the same time that the big Android rivals are saying, yeah, we're moving on from this. We're on to the next thing, which is under display stuff.
Yeah.
And I just feel, it's not unlike Apple to be behind Android trends, because we just know that's how they operate a lot of the time, and that they'd rather be like best than first. So that's not odd, but it feels weird that they'd pick a half step rather than just be like, cool, under display is the thing. Let's just wait till we can do that and make that jump.
Yeah.
But yeah, so we'll see. I mean, hopefully the Google implementation comes up this year, and that would be nice. And the Pixel Foldable is speculated to be a spring launch. I think maybe it's a bit soon for that, but you never know. Or Pixel 7 with under display would be really cool, but we'll see. If not, presumably Samsung will have an improved version for the next Fold.
Hopefully.
I assume they're all in on this now, rather than just going to take it away and be like, yeah, that was crap. Sorry, guys.
Sorry.
I mean, seeing the Z Flip to the Z Flip 3, like that jump.
Yes.
I have high hopes for the under display improvements in a year.
I wonder if they'll put it in the Flip. The new Flip, the Flip 4 or whatever. Whether they'll think it's ready for that now. Or
I mean, it's a bit of extra screen real estate on a smaller display, so it would make sense. Mm.
But equally, that one's kind of affordable-ish. And I reckon they want to keep it that way.
Yeah.
My question would be more because of the they pushed the Z Flip as more kind of a fashion and kind of social phone, if you get what I mean. And so having a good, like having a front camera that is the best front camera they can put in that situation. Yeah. So
that's true. A bit more selfie oriented target market. And and for me, certainly if I was Samsung weighing up, like, well, I can either put in an under display camera or I can take $50 off the price tag. For the Fold, you maybe go with the under display. For the Flip, you take the price cut.
Chop that.
Like, that's just where that is in the market. That's the one where they just got it below a grand. If they could even get it down another £100, $100, you know, that would be incredible. And it would just be a massive seller.
I will buy that.
Yeah.
Yeah, cool. All right, let's move on to today's final topic. A nice little blast from the past. We're going to talk about BlackBerry. I'll be honest, I haven't used a BlackBerry phone in a very long time. I've never owned a BlackBerry phone.
What?
Never in the BlackBerry craze.
How was you not right a part of that?
Do you know what I used when all my mates had BlackBerries? I went for the HTC Desire Z, which had a slide-out keyboard. You turn it on its side and the screen kind of scissored up. It was amazing. Ooh.
I definitely had some weird HTC. I can't remember which one, so I remember the timing of when BlackBerry was, but yeah, I was firmly, I just went from a sort of, you know, the T9 keyboard stuff straight to like the early Androids and HTC stuff. And
I went via
never took the BlackBerry step.
I went via Windows Mobile as well, which also had a slide out keyboard.
I mean, I looked at those. Some of those early Windows Mobile ones were cool.
It was bad. Windows Mobile was a bad experience.
But it looked nice. It was absolutely shocking. Yeah, it looked cool. So good. What a pretty fun OS. Anyway, right. So BlackBerry. Few bits of BlackBerry news. Basically, I'm just going to throw them all out there and then we'll rattle through chatting about them. Firstly, we had this odd development that basically right at the beginning of January, BlackBerry stopped working. They just, you know, RAM kind of just like shut the servers down, so to speak, such that any existing BlackBerry device lost a lot of functionality overnight. Secondly, Onward Mobility, which is the company that last year bought the BlackBerry brand and put out a bold statement saying they were going to make a BlackBerry phone for 2021. This is not a company that makes phones already, but they said, we're going to do this. You are presumably aware that that did not happen. There was no new BlackBerry phone last year. It's been really silent from them for a long time as well. So there was a bit of speculation that this had just completely kicked the bucket. But they did put out a statement in early January confirming that they do still exist. They are still working on the phone. And that they think they should have one out this year. No new information on what it's going to be. But in theory, there is still a new BlackBerry on the way. And then the final thing is not directly BlackBerry related, but Planet Computers, which is a small British company, has been putting out physical keyboard phones for a few years, all through Kickstarter and sort of small scale releases. But they sort of showed off their latest, the Astro Slide at CES, which actually wasn't the first time we've seen it. I'd actually reported on this at least a year or so ago, but it's another one of those phones that's just been, because it was a small scale Kickstarter product, I think they got hit by COVID stuff and delays there a lot worse than other companies. So they really, it was revealed first a year and a half ago, then last year they said it would come out in June 2021 or start shipping in June 2021. That didn't happen, but they showed it off again at CES this year and are, you know, bullish that these things are going to be shipping and they are real. This is a little different to a BlackBerry. The name I give away, Astro Slide, it is a sliding phone where it's got a full kind of full-size smartphone display that then slides back to a landscape orientation, physical QWERTY keyboard with mechanical keys. I like I said, I covered it before, though I haven't yet had the chance to play with one in person, though I'm really hoping one of us will do, because it's kind of cool in its own little way.
It just looks very old school, I think.
Yes, it does.
Like the Nokia communicators of old sort of situation.
Yeah, but then with a full touchscreen and running Android 11, which is pretty novel. It is a bit under spec'd. It's kind of fair to say. It's a Dimensity 800. And again, they've had problems because of the delays. They've ended up using slightly older chips by the time it comes out and things like that. And it was never going to be a really high spec. And they're a small company, so they're not operating at scale, which just means their price per component is higher than others. And so it's not a value phone by any means, and for you get those specs elsewhere for less, but you know, not with a mechanical QWERTY keyboard. You couldn't.
The way you reported it last year, is the 5G aspect of the Astro's name, is that new? Is 5G an addition for them showing it off at CES this year?
Oh, that's a good question. I think that might be the case. Yeah, now that I'm looking at it.
I think that was in the old coverage that we had, which you'd written from like early 2021.
No, they were promising 5G and Wi-Fi 6.
Okay, right. Because that is obviously... That isn't new. That is what Omer Mobility is kind of pitching here, is that's it's the first 5G BlackBerry.
I think they've put 5G in the name now. I think that's the difference.
Yeah, they have, yeah.
My previous coverage, I certainly didn't put 5G in the name when I wrote about it.
Okay.
But I did mention it had 5G. I think they've recognized that actually that's quite a good angle to lean on. And
especially if the rest of the hardware is a little bit middling beyond their, obviously, the physical design of it.
Yeah.
But yeah, no, it was interesting. It was an interesting like 3 days last week. I think we were halfway through. I think it was the 5th when we last did our episode last week or something. So on the 4th, as you said, like loads of legacy BlackBerry devices basically would stop working. BlackBerry, the way you phrased it sounded like they just didn't tell anyone. They were just going to cut them off. But they, I think given like 2 years notice, I think they put out a statement in 2020. This is the company BlackBerry, by the way.
I'm just adding a bit of drama to the whole thing.
And it was dramatic. You succeeded. But yeah, for
all
those people
BlackBerry
who
just woke up,
yeah, I mean,
not working.
They're very attentive. When we write about BlackBerry stuff, people definitely come and look at our content. So BlackBerry fans are passionate.
This is one of the funny things. I kind of joked, you know, at the beginning, like, who's the market for this? And it's not me. And you know, does anyone want to buy these things this year? And to some extent, I still wonder how many people really want to buy these things. But you know, full disclosure, we have a piece summing up all the rumors and speculation on the upcoming Onward Mobility BlackBerry phone, which we were updating all through last year and now for this year. And that has consistently, since we wrote it, been one of the top articles on our site. People really want to know about this upcoming BlackBerry phone.
It's a nostalgia, isn't it? It's a Motorola Razr thing all over again. Like, people just like...
The commenters are very vocal. People are vocal about it. Like, people
I think there's some
know.
Nostalgia, but I think some people just genuinely hate touchscreen keyboards and like physical keyboards and are willing to put up with the downsides they bring on a phone, namely that's just the whole thing is going to be bigger and chunkier for sure. Mm. But I think a lot of people really do like that keyboard experience and miss it. And I think it's partly nostalgia, but partly a genuine, that is a better experience.
I mean, I must admit.
And I kind of get it.
Yeah.
But like autocorrect is awful. It's still awful. Yeah. Years in. And typing on a phone still sucks.
Yeah. I used to love walking down the road with my BlackBerry and just, you know, touch typing as you're walking along, just not looking at the phone at all and just, you know, hammering out a full text message
or
whatever it is.
Which model did you have, Lewis? Were you a bold user? Were you a curve
user?
I had so many.
I had so many BlackBerries. Yeah, I was a huge BlackBerry fan back in the day. It started off with one of the early curves and I went to a bold and then I got really into modding the cases. So I used to like put off the cases and change color and... I used to do that for people a bit.
In case anyone watching or listening was unsure of our geeky credentials here, Lewis is modding BlackBerry cases left, right, and center.
Yeah, that was when I was like 16, 17 as well.
Amazing.
Just living my best life.
But yeah, the on the 4th, the BlackBerry services for BBOS 7.1 and previously BBOS 10 and Playbook OS, which was, if you remember, the BlackBerry had a tablet for a little while. They all kind of ceased to operate. Yeah, I know, right? I totally forgot until I came to update the piece. And that media attention, I think, really kind of spurred on BlackBerry fans and the media to look into Onward Mobility, because when you look, they hadn't updated anything, social media channels, their website, anything since about mid-2021. And it just seemed a little suspect considering everything they'd promised.
Yeah.
And, you know, looking at their website on the 5th of Jan, which is when I updated all our BlackBerry content, they still had this banner on the homepage saying coming 2021 for this BlackBerry phone. And then we were like, well, clearly no. So maybe 2022. And then the next day they published a blog post on the website and it was titled, a bit apocryphally, contrary to popular belief, we are not dead. And they do say who they're pulling that quote from or tweaking that quote from. But effectively it was saying, we're still around, we're still working on it. Trying to launch a phone in 2021 turned out to be really, really hard, which, I mean...
I'm sympathetic to them, I can imagine. Computers had the exact same thing. And
no
shame. Similar size, small company.
I mean, Huawei had the same problem. Yeah. I mean,
biggest tech companies in the world, Samsung couldn't launch the S21 FE until this January. Samsung and Huawei can't get their phones out the door in time, then I'm totally sympathetic to Onward Mobility and Planet Computers for also struggling with 1% of the workforce and budget, if not less than that.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, like, the... Onward Mobility, it was interesting because, like, you know, regardless of how the BlackBerry name has fallen out of favor in terms of market share in the mobile space, people know the name. People know what the products used to be like and stood for. Onward Mobility, as an entity responsible for making the next BlackBerry, is a completely unknown quantity in terms of how effectively they can build this new phone. I'm totally happy to give them the leeway. I'm not like hankering for the next BlackBerry, but I know that plenty of people are. So I'm happy to give them a wide berth and let them figure it out in their own time and get it right rather than try and rush it, for sure.
Yeah.
I'm interested to see the kind of approach they take with it, because one of the interesting things about the way Planet Computers have approached theirs is they very consciously lent into, to be blunt, a geeky audience. And they've really lent into the people who want this device are probably massive nerds and they want other features that are not on mainstream phones. So, for example, the Astro Slide ships with Android 11 by default, but you can also boot it into Linux. And like they've designed it, they've like baked in support for Linux geeky. For it to make it easy to do that.
Wow.
And this is like a smaller one, but they've included a micro SD card slot, which is less and less common, but they made a point of being like expandable storage, you're going to get that. So that they're definitely openly acknowledging their audience is not the standard phone audience. And the things people want from this phone are not necessarily the things people want from a standard high-end smartphone. But then they've also not skimped too much. I'm actually looking at coverage of the new, the version they've unveiled at CES, and it is tweaked a little bit from what I was introduced to last year. One of the big things for me is it's got wireless charging now, which I'm pretty sure they weren't planning to offer before. But again, that's a big, high-end kind of feature that you would totally expect a brand this size to just say, we can't really do wireless charging. We were just talking earlier, Honor's just shipping a high-end premium foldable phone, and they didn't bother to put wireless charging in it. But this little company is putting in 30-watt wired charging and Qi wireless charging, which is great. They've also made a point, and this is the same as was before, but there is a 48-megapixel, I think it's just a single rear camera, but it's a 48-megapixel Sony sensor.
Yeah, single.
And I can't remember exactly which one it is, but I think I think it's the one that OnePlus used for 4 years.
It doesn't even say on their website. It just says Sony sensor.
Yeah,
because I'm reading.
I remember
586, was it?
I think it's the 586 or something like that. But anyway, I remember it chatting to some of the people from Planet Computers, and they were quite bullish that they were like, yeah, we've gotten a good Sony sensor. And this was a year and a half ago. So at that point, and I think it was that one. And it wasn't the latest model even at that point. But it was that is a good phone sensor. It's not the absolute highest spec, but that's going to be a pretty good camera.
And what I will say about the keyboard, it's great to see. I mean, for one, a mechanical keyboard on a phone like that.
Yeah,
mechanical keyboard. That sounds great. And also, they're doing a lot of different keyboards, like for a lot of different countries. It might just be a little UK company, but they're trying to get this worldwide.
Yeah, they're trying to make sure it started as a Kickstarter thing. I think they are hoping to be able to sell them through their web store more generally after that. But you could pick what keys you wanted for your country. I think they also have some programmable keys on there.
They do.
So there's some stuff you can map to as shortcuts to open specific apps or things like that by hitting that button.
And apparently you've got an actual dedicated button on the phone itself that's programmable as well. So you can
use
that. Yeah, so there's some cool little bits here, I think. I'm reading through the specs on the page. I'm like, do you know what? The more I read about it, the more I'm like,
we've already asked when they have samples, we'd like to review one. So, Lewis, if you want it, I'm sure you can get hands on it and be the one to bring it
keyboard.
To the fast charge in a review form.
Yeah,
it's an interesting one for sure.
One of Astro is kind of addressing this partly. But one of the huge changes that I think since BlackBerry left, they kind of left something of a vacuum in terms of the market they were catering for. Yes, consumers bought them, but also as an enterprise mobile device, that's BlackBerry's kind of bread and butter, right? And that means that since 2015, technically, yes, I know TCL made some BlackBerries in between, but first and foremost, I think Apple and Samsung have moved into that space as the enterprise device providers. So Onward Mobility is going to have to bring a new BlackBerry into that market, try and approach those same customers who have now already spent the last 2, 3, 4 years using other manufacturers' phones for their enterprise devices, which makes it all the more difficult, I think.
And that's a really uphill battle, especially because more and more now compared to when BlackBerry dominated, so much of that is about security.
Yeah.
And complex, you know, cybersecurity stuff that is, you know, expensive to bake in and requires a whole different set of expertise. And I do wonder if they have, if they are able to even try and approach the kind of levels of security that enterprise use often demands.
Well, a lot of the stories around the BlackBerry were about the hardware that we're expecting. The thing that not as many people were asking about is what has happened to BlackBerry, the company, as in Research in Motion, who used to make these phones. Mm-hmm. And they've transitioned, I think it seems fairly successfully, into a full-on IoT and cybersecurity firm. Like,
oh, right, yeah.
And so they actually hit me up today based on the coverage, and I emailed the PRs for BlackBerry back, as in not Onward Mobility, just to be clear.
Asking whether
they'd been approached by Onward Mobility for any security stuff for that BlackBerry phone, because that makes perfect sense. BlackBerry did also consult with TCL when they did their DTEC security software on their Android phone. So it's not completely out of the question.
Not out of the question. Cool.
Yeah, so it would be interesting to know whether BlackBerry, the company, has any at all involvement with the BlackBerry phone that Onward Mobility is going to make this year.
Yeah, I mean, it all comes down, not that bit, but the question of whether they can become an enterprise solution. It all comes down to the question of like what they're aiming for, like the scale they're trying to hit here. Because Planet Computers, I'm sure Planet Computers would love to become a massive phone company, but certainly they're not out the gate trying to do that. They
that
don't
product
seem to
is
be,
not that.
Yeah, they're not, you know, and even from an enterprise perspective, they're not really setting out to be like, hey, buy 500 of these for your company. They're really just targeting individual users who are, you know, either nostalgic for these kind of keyboards, who maybe there's accessibility reasons you might prefer a physical keyboard, maybe you just prefer typing on it, or maybe you love the idea of a phone that runs Linux and all the little kind of geeky details it has. But it's very much, you know, maybe the IT guy in your company buys this phone.
Yeah.
But he's buying it for himself, you know, or herself. They're not buying it for everyone in the company. And it doesn't feel like Planet Computers is trying to be that. Maybe they would love to be, and maybe they're long-term aiming to be, but certainly short-term, that doesn't seem to be the plan.
I mean, if
I
the
just
selling
wonder
point,
where Onward Mobility are going with it. Yeah.
Yeah, if one of the selling points is that it can boot to Linux, you're like, yeah, this is not a mass market device exactly. in any way, shape, or form. I at this point, I feel like it is fundamentally the fans first. Yeah. But maybe that's their strategy. They hope that the fans pick up their device. This is Onward Mobility I'm talking about. Pick up their device and shout about it, because BlackBerry fans are very vocal. And that has a snowball effect. That would be the strategy I would probably imagine is one of the stronger than trying to chase after an enterprise like market that's already invested so much in other brands now since BlackBerry, the company's exit from the space. But it is a bit of a gamble for sure.
I think there's still a space for them to kind of appeal to small business owners rather than big enterprise, kind of, you know, 500 people plus companies. There's still, you know, a lot of people that have one or, you know, it's just you running the business and you just want something where you can enter, you know, Excel numbers a little bit easier on your keyboard.
Yeah,
I guess you don't need the full enterprise kind of thing, protection or whatever.
Yeah, a lot of those, I guess, teens who grew up using BlackBerries now are also professionals.
Yeah, I mean,
who
maybe
might have a lot
time.
Of love for the BlackBerry. So
suddenly, the people with BlackBerry nostalgia may be the people with, you know, buying power at the moment, which may help them. Because there is the elephant in the room here is this isn't the first time BlackBerry has died and then another company has come in. As you mentioned, Toddy, TCL came in and made BlackBerry phones for a while, and they were not the original BlackBerry company. And then they stopped because they were not making enough money from selling BlackBerry phones. And that's TCL. That's a big company with a lot of R&D behind them already. They weren't coming from scratch. They already had distribution and production and all this stuff. And they couldn't justify it. So you have to look at this and say, why and how do Onward Mobility intend to succeed where an enormous company like TCL failed?
Yeah.
Which is again why I asked the question about what they're aiming for, because I can't believe they are aiming mass market. Because if you want to say why TCL failed, it's well, maybe that TCL needed mass market sales to justify their outlay and the scale they run at. It needs to be a mass market product.
Yeah.
Maybe Onward Mobility doesn't need that. Maybe they can sell a lot fewer of them, you know, in 1 year, but operate at a scale and a price point where they survive on that. in a way that if TCL's selling, you know, less than 100,000 phones, they're not going to keep going. But if you, relatively small startup, are selling less than 100,000, that could be still amazing for you.
I will say that the CEO of Onward Mobility looks like he's around our age. So he's the guy with buying power to keep the BlackBerry brand going.
There we go.
I mean, if you go on LinkedIn as well, like the whole Onward Mobility team is about six people. Some of them have backgrounds in an industry where you could be like, okay, that is definitely like a viable skill set to be able to bring a phone to market out of nothing. It'd be interesting to see, just how big they're going to try and reach with their first product. In terms of hardware, because obviously, like, the Planet Computer's Astro is a fully realized product without any kind of brand following yet, really.
Yeah.
And Onward Mobility basically have the opposite situation where they have a non-existent product, but a very, dedicated, passionate fan base waiting in the wings to kind of get involved.
I remember being a little surprised when the Onward Mobility buying the brand happened, because at the time I was sort of like, oh, I wonder if Planet Computers looked at that, because they were already making these phones with physical keyboards. The Astro Side is their third product. And, you know, both the two before are physical keyboard phones, I believe. So they were already there building these things. And you have to wonder if they looked and said, oh, wouldn't we sell a lot more of these if they said BlackBerry on them?
I mean,
and they were already up and going with making them. And you do kind of think really the best outcome here would be Planet Computers making BlackBerries, because they already know how to make the hardware. They just need the brand name to get them a bigger reach.
Yeah. If Onward Mobility smart, they maybe just should churn and license the hardware from Astro as well.
Yeah, like, if the first Onward Mobility BlackBerry is a sliding, we'll know what's happened. Because the flip side of that is, I'm worried for Planet Computers, because they have a little niche where they are the people who make physical keyboard phones. But if Onward Mobility can pull it off and they can sustain putting out one new BlackBerry every year or two, then I don't know, when you're that person looking up, I want to buy a phone with a physical keyboard.
Yeah.
You probably buy the one that says BlackBerry on it, you know?
Yeah.
And I wonder, how Planet Computers keep themselves going in that space.
I don't know if either of you guys have thought about what you'd want from this new BlackBerry, but like in my head going...
One, so, you know,
sure,
I'm no
sure. Okay, what do you think the market would benefit phones. From then, I guess, is what I mean to say. But in my head, like the Priv, which was BlackBerry's last official of their own like phones and their first Android phone, did pretty well. Like, yes, it was a bit clunky and ugly to look at, but it did have a physical keyboard that slid out, and the touchscreen worked well, and the interplay actually worked surprisingly well. I could just see a refined Priv would be really good.
Yeah. I do think a sliding form factor is probably the way to go.
Yeah.
Just because that old BlackBerry shape doesn't give you enough screen. And I know they did kind of have touchscreen ones, but I think for today's, the way the Astro Slide is designed is that it can be closed, and it's a regular Android phone with a big, six point something inch display. But then you can slide it out and you've got the keyboard when you want it. And that some variation of that seems like the only way you can go, because I think as much as people want the keyboard, they don't want to give up on the screen.
Yeah. And based on our understanding of Android formatting to odd aspect ratios and stuff as well, it's not,
nothing
it would
else.
Definitely work against them, regardless of what they, regardless
I don't want
to
be
to
the
do.
One trying to make a square UI for Android.
I think for me, I like the sliding idea with the keyboard, but instead of going like the Astro Slide, where it's kind of a landscape, I'd want a portrait slide and slide up.
Yeah. So again, Priv-like.
Yeah, essentially, with a smaller keyboard with nice feedback, because then you get the full kind of portrait experience. And I just don't like phones in landscape in general. You lose space on screen, especially when you're texting and stuff like that. So I'm just... I don't know. I'm always more portrait in most apps, even when I'm on an iPad and stuff like that.
I mean, platforms like TikTok and Snapchat right there with you with that approach.
Well, the TikTok did do a landscape layout on iPad for a while. It was weird. Yeah, it was really weird. It was just kind of extra space on each side. It wasn't anything there. And then they kind of just removed it a few updates ago. Didn't say a single word about it. They were like, all right, well, that didn't happen.
But yeah, that is one of the interesting things, the landscape thing, because I'm just double checking, but all of Planet Computer's products, they're three. The Gemini PDA, the Cosmo Communicator, and the Astro Slide. I love their names. They are really something. But they're all landscape orientation with the keyboard. They've changed the design up. The sliding thing is the new thing, because it means, I think before they were more like clamshell. Mm-hmm. So they closed and you had to open them. The slide is designed so that when it's shut, it just looks like a phone, but a chunky one. But they've all been designed so that the keyboard is a landscape keyboard. When you use it, the screen is landscape while you've got the keyboard going, which is interesting, yeah, that they haven't tried for that priv style portrait space. So maybe that's the sensible place for BlackBerry to go. It's more the classic BlackBerry design, if nothing else. Yeah. And it clearly marks them out as different to what these guys are doing.
Yeah, for sure. I'm trying to remember the name of it, but there was... Maybe it was the Sony Ericsson, but as we touched on Windows Mobile, there was an old Sony Xperia. I thought it was called the Pro, but obviously it's not called the Xperia Pro because we have that now. But it was a Windows Mobile device that slid to the side like the Astro. And they tried to fit that same niche. It's just funny that we're kind of like dancing around like back. Sony overlaps. Yeah.
Well, it's the same with, you know, the foldables are just going back to the old clamshells, aren't they? Just figuring out how they work with our current tech.
Oh, there you go, the Xperia X1, if you can see that.
Yeah,
that had a slide-out keyboard.
Yeah.
I thought it was the coolest piece of tech at the time when it came out. It was terrible to use.
Wow, I'm looking at leaked photos from before it was announced, and I'm just like, wow, these are old school.
Wow. This is bad. This is bad design.
This is interesting, to say the least.
Yeah, I guess Onward Mobility has a lot of what not to do. There's a good track record of what not to do in terms of both hardware design and market strategy.
Yep.
Hopefully they can apply that in a way that
works exactly for them. They've got to learn as much from what would be good as from what has already been tried specifically with BlackBerry.
Yes,
and
exactly.
Gone wrong and you know what to avoid. Anyway, so there is a BlackBerry fan this year, theoretically. I wouldn't expect it anytime soon, because that statement from Onward Mobility certainly wasn't saying we're announcing in March or anything like that.
Not very confident.
It still sounds like it will be quite a while away.
What they have said is they are going to be a lot more forthcoming with updates and information. Yes. So rather than leaving it 6 months, they actually might say stuff every now and then about what they're up to, which should be good.
So hopefully hear more along the way. In the meantime, the Astro Slide, just double checking, I slightly misspoke. It is now the CS... appearance was a full launch. It's now available to pre-order. So it was previously just a crowdfunded phone, but you can now go to the Planet Computers website and you can pre-order one. They are going to be shipping from March. So if you want a mechanical
Sony
Astro Slide, exactly. you can actually order one now and you'll get it from March. And you get a lot of keyboard options still if you do that. Wasn't just for Kickstarter. You could go US, Japanese, UK, German, Finnish and Swedish, Italian, 24. Korean, Arabic.
Wow.
You can get a Dvorak keyboard from them.
Oh,
incredible.
Tell John Porter at The Verge, he'll be thrilled.
24 international layouts.
I want to see John Porter review this as a keyboard.
Yes.
Just run a keyboard review of the Astro Slide. This has been Fast Charge, the podcast from Tech Advisor. I can say words in the right order. Thank you to everyone who's been watching. Thank you to Toddy and Lewis for joining me this week. We will be back same time, same place next week. No idea what's going to happen next week, but we'll be talking some sort of nonsense as always. So until then, bye.
Bye.